Hi friends, welcome to this edition of VBS NeuroMed, a series of e-learning lectures specially designed for this series study at home kind of videos. I also called it as lockdown lectures because we are currently going through the pandemic. There are no classes running. Most of the teaching is online currently going on. I hope this will act as some kind of a catalyst to keep the students engaged and motivated. I am hopeful that shortly this crisis will pass and classes will start, in which case we can catch up with the practicals. In the meanwhile, this can be treated as an introductory theory class for the same. The topic particularly chosen for this is cerebrum surfaces. Here, I will cover the supralateral surface, the medial surface, and the inferior surface, and take you on a panoramic tour of salient features of each of these surfaces. I am Dr. Balasubramanian. I work as a professor in the Department of Anatomy here at St. John's Medical College, Bangalore. Surface of the cerebrum, I repeat, here is the actual brain, one half of the cerebrum, one hemisphere. You can see in the medial half, the most important, the key structure or the signature item which hits the eye is right at the center, marked by the red arrow number 1.cc, corpus callosum. By now you have realized that the two halves of the brain work not only in synchrony with each other, but it's basically a symphony in terms of controlling the rest of the body. As a result, there will be a lot of, you know, shall we say, hemisphere cross communications that will be required. To subserve this is this corpus callosum. Corpus callosum is the largest band of commissural fibers. That means they run from one brain to the opposite hemisphere. This is the largest bundle, and looking at the size and the evolution of the human brain, it is not surprising that the size of the corpus callosum is also equally enormous. Next, we are going to identify some of the important, not all, some of the important sulci and gyri seen in this specimen. Item number 2 is a very deep sulcus on the medial side. That's the parieto-occipital sulcus. I repeat, it's a very deep sulcus. Parieto-occipital sulcus. Another sulcus behind it is the calcarine sulcus, which is equally deep, if not more deep. It is so deep that it forms a small impression or a elevation on the medial wall of the posterior horn of the lateral horn, of the lateral ventricle. That in the video you will see, I have called it as the calcar avis. I repeat, when you look at the video, remember this information, that enlargement or the swelling on the medial wall of the posterior horn of the lateral ventricle is the calcar avis. This sulcus is the calcarine sulcus that contributes to the calcar avis. Next, now you see, there are 3 items marked 1, 2, and 3. Now we will slowly try to identify each one. Item number 1 is the sulcus immediately above the corpus callosum. I repeat, item number 1 is immediately above the corpus callosum. So it is the callosal sulcus. K callosal sulcus. Item number 2 is the immediate gyrus above it, therefore that has to be the callosal gyrus. Okay, callosal gyrus, or more common we use the word cingulate gyrus, because there is another sulcus right above it called the cingulate sulcus. I have not shown here, but the sulcus is too very clearly visible. The third item is the supraspleneal sulcus. I repeat, the third item is the supraspleneal sulcus. Now we see all the three items have come to view. You can correlate. Next, yet three more items we are trying to identify. One is the gyrus cingulus. I told you, the cingulate gyrus, now marked. Item number 2 is the paracentral lobule. Remember, you can see a small bit of the central sulcus projecting into the paracentral lobule. I repeat, a small amount of the central sulcus projecting this side on the medial side. Now that central sulcus is the dominant sulcus on the supralateral surface, which we will examine in the other view. Remember, important point in paracentral lobule is the projection of the central sulcus from the opposite side. Next, item number 3 is precuneus. I repeat, is precuneus. There are more items coming up in this discussion. Now you see, item number now I was just talking about the central sulcus, and now that label has appeared. You see, the area, the gyrus around it, was what I had called it as paracentral lobule. Now item number 1 is the frontal sulcus. I repeat, item number 1 was the frontal sulcus, or a more specific name, medial frontal gyrus. I repeat, medial frontal gyrus. Next, item number 2, we run to the posterior aspect, that is more to the posterior and occipital area. That area is the cuneus. I repeat, that is the cuneus. Therefore, from this discussion, it is obvious that the cuneus is a huge island of cortical tissue in between the parieto-occipital sulcus and the calcarine sulcus. I repeat, these two, between the two sulci, is the cuneus. Next, right below the calcarine, see, I have already introduced you to the calcarine sulcus. Okay, now the calcarine sulcus separates the cuneus from another gyrus. That gyrus is called the lingual gyrus. I repeat, it is called the lingual gyrus. Therefore, in this photograph, or in this particular slide, we have an anchor point, that is the central sulcus. The discussion of the paracentral lobule around it has already been done. Next, in the front, that is in the front end, or the frontal end of the medial surface, is the medial frontal gyrus. More posteriorly towards the occipital pole is the cuneus, between the parieto-occipital sulcus and the calcarine sulcus. The calcarine sulcus itself separates the cuneus from the lingual sulcus inferiorly. Next. Now, did you notice that this is no more medial surface? This is the, which surface is this?
Superolateral.
Supralateral surface. Supralateral surface. Remember, unless you separate the two hemispheres, you cannot see the medial sulcus. The two medial surfaces are virtually on either sides of the fax cerebri. Generally not visible unless you cut the cerebrum through the corpus callosum, through the third ventricle, and split it into two. Unless you do that, the medial surface is not obvious. Whereas the supralateral surface is generally the presenting surface when you open the calvarium. Okay, once you remove the dural flap, the presenting surface will be the supralateral surface. It goes without saying that this supralateral surface has an upper border, very close to the superior sagittal sinus. It has a lower border. I repeat, it has a lower border, two prominent borders, upper and lower. Now, the lower border, generally speaking, we define it along the lower border of the temporal lobe, extending up to the occipital pole posteriorly. However, note, this partly extends into the frontal lobe also. That means there are two lower borders. The anterior one third is roughly the frontal lower border. The rest of it, you know, probably more than two thirds, the rest of it is the temporal inferior border. See, for the first time in your anatomy knowledge, you are seeing two borders with more detailed description. Yeah, a frontal inferior border and a temporal inferior border. Now you see, the central sulcus is coming into full view on the supralateral surface. We know that the central sulcus is the most important in terms of a functional distinction of the areas. The central sulcus becomes very, very important. It virtually runs from the upper border down till it coincides with the lateral sulcus. That's the other sulcus that is there. Now, it is obvious, although not shown by labels, that there is a green arrow in front and a blue arrow behind. These are the gyri corresponding to the central sulcus. Therefore, we have a pre-central gyrus and a post-central gyrus. Okay, I'm sure your theory knowledge, you will back up mentioning that the pre-central gyrus is associated with, is it motor or sensory? Pre-central.
Motor.
Motor. Correspondingly, the other one, post-central gyrus, is the sensory cortex or the sensory gyrus. Okay, next. Similarly, just because we defined a gyrus in front and behind the central sulcus, you will have to demarcate the anterior boundaries of anterior and posterior boundaries of these two gyri. Thus, the anterior the sulcus anterior to the precentral gyrus is the precentral sulcus, shown here by the green arrow, and the sulcus posterior to the postcentral gyrus is the postcentral sulcus. That means there is a central sulcus, there is a precentral sulcus, and a postcentral sulcus. And between these three sulci are present two gyri, precentral and the postcentral gyri. Now you can trace the central sulcus down almost to the junction with the lateral sulcus. Therefore, the other sulcus, very, very clearly visible here, is the one running posteriorly towards the parietal lobe. Now it is roughly at the junction of the frontal and the temporal lobes. From there, the lateral sulcus runs posteriorly. Let's see that now in better view. Now, a little bit before that, the area in front of the precentral sulcus, that means the green arrow which I showed you in the previous slide, is the frontal lobe. That lobe has three gyri: superior, shown by a red arrow flashing, a green arrow, and a blue arrow. They are respectively the superior, middle, and inferior frontal gyri. Three gyri separated by two sulci, respectively the superior frontal sulcus and the inferior frontal sulcus. Next, let's see what's coming up next. Now you see, the flashing red arrow is the lateral sulcus. Okay, you see, roughly the location, tip of the arrow is at the junction between the lower end of the central sulcus and the beginning of the posterior limb of the lateral sulcus. Now, this sulcus is extremely, extremely important for another reason. that is where the internal carotid artery branch, okay, that goes to this aspect, supralateral surface, is lodged. Virtually the main part of the internal carotid artery is located there. Next, I have also drawn your attention by three arrows onto the temporal lobe: a brown arrow superior, a green arrow in the middle, and a blue arrow below. Three respectively, these are the superior, middle, and inferior temporal gyri, separated by two sulci, namely the superior and the inferior temporal sulci, just like frontal, correspondingly in the temporal. Next, a few more words about this important lateral sulcus is worth it. You can see the flashing arrow, the tip of the flashing arrow is exactly at the junction between the central sulcus and the posterior ramus, or the posterior limb of the lateral sulcus. In fact, the posterior limb, I have actually put the brown arrow. Now, the green arrow and the blue arrow is a little in anterior. They are respectively anterior ascending and anterior horizontal sulci. They are the branches of the lateral sulcus. Now, at the point where the anterior ascending and the anterior horizontal sulci meet, you can see in a more deeper plane, therefore less clearly focused, is the cortical aspect of the insula. I mean, insula is a very deep island of cortical tissue. You can see that very, very clearly there. Next, you see, that's the insula. The red flashing arrow is the insula. Next, when you trace the posterior limb of the lateral sulcus as far as possible, it intersects with another sulcus, that is the parieto-occipital sulcus. See, it intersects, and that is marked here by the brown arrow. The brown arrow is the parieto-occipital sulcus. Because of this location, this parieto-occipital sulcus demarcates an upper and a lower, that is superior and inferior parietal lobule. I repeat, superior and inferior parietal lobule. Next, similarly, in the occipital region, remember, we are still in the supralateral surface. Similarly, in the occipital region of the supralateral surface, you can see there is a flashing arrow. That arrow refers to the lateral occipital sulcus. I repeat, lateral occipital sulcus. It therefore provides a gyrus above superior and a gyrus below by the same name. Next. Now, I'm sure all of you will appreciate that we are no more on the supralateral surface. We are now on the inferior surface. The most striking thing about the inferior surface is there are two components in this area. One is the temporal part posteriorly. The larger posterior part is the temporal aspect of the inferior surface. And in front of it, the frontal aspect of the inferior surface. Because we already got a premonition about it, that there are two borders, temporal and frontal. Similarly, the surfaces are also double. Although overall we are seeing the inferior surface, the anterior part is the orbital component of the inferior surface, and the rest of it is the temporal component of the inferior surface. The orbital component is also known as the frontal component. It doesn't make any difference. Now, in the orbital component, forget that arrow marks right now. Concentrate on the dotted circle. You know, there is a blue, white, dotted circle. Now, that circle encloses a H-shaped sulcus. That's the orbital sulcus. Because it is H-shaped, it demarcates this area into four gyri: an anterior, a posterior, a medial and a lateral orbital gyrus. Okay, so these four gyri are generally referred to as the orbital gyri. Next, look at the blue arrow. None of them are flashing. The blue arrow, tip of which is pointing to the olfactory sulcus. Lodged in the olfactory sulcus is the olfactory tract and the olfactory bulb. Remember, the anterior part of this tract and bulb has been cut off, so the sulcus is visible. Otherwise, if the olfactory tract and the bulb are intact, you cannot see the sulcus. So deliberately we have chopped off to show the sulcus. We have left a little bit to the proximal part to give you the understanding that it is nothing but the olfactory nerve, the first cranial nerve. Now, this olfactory sulcus is a little lateral to the midline. Therefore, it encloses a gyrus between the midline and the sulcus. That gyrus is the gyrus rectus. I repeat, that's the gyrus rectus. Next, let's move on to the temporal aspect of the inferior surface. I hope you are able to understand what I'm talking. I introduce you to the point that the inferior surface is in two components, a frontal or an orbital component and a posterior or a temporal component. We have finished the orbital component, we are moving on to the temporal component. Now, the word uncus probably is known to you in a discussion of the cavernous sinus. You may have heard about it, but that part is a gyrus at the tip of the inferior surface of the temporal lobe that's been marked here by a green arrow, that is the uncus. The posterior continuation of the uncus, I repeat, the posterior continuation of the uncus is the parahippocampal gyrus. Is the parahippocampal gyrus. Next, this parahippocampal is limited laterally by a sulcus known as collateral sulcus. Remember, don't confuse this with calcarine sulcus, which we talked of a little earlier. That is different. This is collateral sulcus. I repeat, therefore, this slide has uncus marked in green, parahippocampal gyrus marked in an L-shaped blue arrow, and a collateral sulcus limiting it laterally and marked here again by a blue straight arrow. Next, this collateral sulcus, which I mentioned, further lateral to it, there is an occipitotemporal sulcus. It's much more lateral to the collateral sulcus. So that means between the collateral sulcus shown previously and now being shown by a blue L-shaped arrow, namely the occipitotemporal sulcus, between these two is located the medial occipitotemporal gyrus. Medial occipitotemporal gyrus. And the only gyrus left on the other side marked in green